church with Brad Crum. He sang gospel music in Carsonville for an hour last night, and it was like being in church. It was really wonderful. I have a few announcements to make. We have some people that we want to pray for that won't necessarily make it to our prayer list, so if you jot their names down on your bulletin. One of them is Carter Twigg, a young man who works at Lake Tobias and was struck by an automobile while riding his bike this week. So I'm not sure the extent of his injuries, but please pray for Carter. Peg Kissinger, who, as you know, is Kyle's grandmother and mom of Ron Kissinger across the street. She's on hospice and needs your prayers. She seems to be in the very final stages, dramatically and quickly. And then also entering hospice is Cassie Kiefer. So please be praying for her to have good continuous visits with family. She's got a lot of company stopping by, so that's a blessing. But if you feel inclined to stop by and say hi to her, she's definitely full of good stories and lots of good thoughts. So please keep her in your prayers. Does anyone know if Dean Perstetter had any damage from the tornado? I haven't had a chance to call him yet. All right, I'll be reaching out to him this week. And any prayer updates or additions from you all? Tomorrow is the deadline for the Women of the ELCA convention in St. John's, Berrysburg. It's being held in a rural location, and we've been told that if people don't come from the rural areas, we're going to look bad. So the registration forms are over here on the desk. Please go ahead and do it for $25. You'll have a nice breakfast and lunch, and you'll hear me preach in another setting, as if you don't get enough of me. The other thing is, at this point with the Tiki Trot, I think we have more sponsors than we do runners. We need runners and walkers and participators, or sponsors, but most of all, we need people to run or walk. So these forms also are out here on the table, and I encourage you to sign up. All right, I think that's, Katie?
And if you don't want to do that, you can volunteer, that would be great too. On the race day.
Okay. All right. You heard that, right?
And next week we'll be passing around an items list of things because we're going to be putting together goodie bags for before the race and things for after the race for the runners and walkers. So that list will be ready next week.
Okay. All right. Very good. And if you haven't already signed up for the church picnic, please do so. And there's another board up there. And then we have... Oh, look at that, magically appearing things for the personal care kits. But keep them coming, because last year we set a record of all the churches in the area for personal care kits, and we wowed them, so let's keep wowing them. All right, is that it for announcements? I don't want to miss anybody. All right, welcome to church this morning, and we're so glad you're here. Let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you.
approaches the altar. Okay, let's do a brief order of confession and forgiveness. Please stand as you're able. Now, do I need to teach you all how to put three fingers together to do the sign of the cross the way I've been doing the children? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves.
We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
First reading comes from Joshua 24. And then Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Now therefore, revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served on the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve. Whether the gods your ancestors served in the region of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord, our God, who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, and out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight. He protected us along all the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, and the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God." Grant the peace.
Please join me in responsibly reciting parts of Psalm 34. "The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and God's ears are open to their cry.
The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, who raise their numbers from the heaven and the earth.
The righteous cry, and the Lord hears them, and delivers them from all their troubles.
The Lord is near to the broken hearted, and saves those who
bring death to the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be punished. O Lord, you redeem the life of your servants, and those who put their trust in you will not be punished.
Second reading comes from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 20. Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith, with which you will be able to, quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always preserve in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I must speak. Here ends the speech.
Oh, you can sit on the floor.
Neither will you be the broadcaster and hold that in front of them when they talk. Did you guys get your children's bulletins yet? Okay. So, today in the second reading, we talked about the armor of God. So I'm going to ask you a question. Darcy, have you started to play any sports yet? You're a dancer, aren't you? Okay, so let's see what these guys say about sports. When you go to play soccer, do you wear the same shoes you have on now? Do you? Come on, tell me the real answer. Okay. You wear special shoes. Do you know why you wear those special shoes? Because they help you to be safe. If you didn't have those special shoes, when you went to change direction, you could go, whoa, whoa, and you might slip and fall and hurt yourself. Do you wear something up here when you play soccer? Miles, I know you. What are those things called, do you know? Shin guards, that's right. What does that mean, a shin guard? What's it doing? What's its job? Exactly, exactly. Your shin is that part that protects you. Exactly. So in today's second reading, we talked about the armor of God, and there are some things that are special. Darcy, when you do your ballet, do you wear flip-flops?
No.
No. What do you wear?
Ballet shoes.
And do the ballet shoes help you do ballet?
Yes.
Exactly. So God says that we have special shoes that are called the shoes of the gospel of peace. That's a big mouthful, isn't it? God also says we have a belt. You probably don't even know what a belt is, do you? You know what a belt is? What's a belt do? Tell me.
Keep the
pants. Yeah. Exactly. So God says there's a belt that God gives you, and it's God's armor, and it's the belt of truth. So can you go like this? Can you pretend to put a belt on, the belt of truth? Mine's going to be a tie belt. Okay, let's put on the shoes of peace, shall we? Shoes of peace. Okay, then we're going to put on a breastplate. Do you know what that is? That's a thing that goes over your whole chest like this. And it's heavy. You might have seen people who are doing jousting. You know what jousting is? When they ride on a horse and they go to knock each other off. So we have a breastplate of righteousness. Then we have something on our head. Hold your hands up here and say we have a helmet of salvation. Can you say that? The helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness. Okay, then we got something really heavy to pick up. Are you ready? The shield of faith. Can you pick it up? Oh my gosh, it's so heavy. And you hold it right up in front of you. Okay, one last thing. One last thing. So all those things were armor, right? One last thing is really big. Ready? Okay, we've got, in our other hand, we're going to pick up a sword. The sword that is the Word of God. So just think about it. So we have, look, we have armor that goes from our head all the way down to our feet, and that covers us, and we have one weapon, which is what? The Word of God. All right, well, I'm going to preach more about that. And so the next time you put on your shin guards or your ballet slippers or your soccer cleats, will you think about the armor of God? Can you do that for me? Ready to pray? Miles, ready? Hands together. Dear Lord, thank you for giving us special gear to protect us and to help us to do things better. Please keep us safe as we dance and play sports. And help us to always remember that you are with us. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Good job, guys. Take your miles, here's your penny. today was one of those days where, first of all, in the gospel lesson, the first half of it is what I preached on last week. So if you want preaching on the first half of our gospel reading, you'll have to watch the recorded thing on YouTube. Today I'd like to look at the different readings. As I read about Joshua and saw how he wanted to gather all the people, and then he did, I was like, what? He just wanted to do it, and then it happened? How did he do that? How did he succeed at gathering all the people? The tribes, the men, women, and children that were part of the overall community according to their heritage and location. How did he manage to gather the elders, the heads, the judges, and officers, all the people with titles and responsibilities over others? He gathered them and they came. Doesn't say how long it took him. Maybe it took him a while. Anyway, the people came and they presented themselves before God, just as you all have this morning. For that, I'm grateful. Then, like a good preacher, Joshua tells them, in sincere faithfulness, they ought to revere God. Joshua instructs before directing them to choose whom they will serve. The people take instruction. They follow directions. Therefore, Joshua confidently asks them to declare who they've decided to serve. As Bob Dylan sang in one of his most iconic Christian melodies, although most people don't recognize it as a Christian song, you're going to have to serve somebody. It might be the devil, or it might be the Lord, but you're going to have to serve somebody. I wish people would admit just that. So if you're unwilling to serve the Lord, you will serve somebody. Won't you say who that is? When the people gathered and presented themselves before God, they also recalled what God had done for them. Like them, we can recall how God has brought us safely from one place to another, from one period of our lives that may have been tough to another, along the way showing us signs of encouragement, protection, and sparing us from the worst that could have happened. Is there anyone here that can't recall that? We may recall that God didn't allow strangers to take advantage of us, like they may have. God's probably even driven away people or obstacles that might have made it even more difficult or impossible for you to accomplish what you have. Like people in Joshua's time, after recalling where they'd been and realizing where they'd gotten to, they decided to serve the Lord. They claimed God as theirs because of what God had already done. It doesn't take much faith to choose what's already worked. Once a product manufacturer, a person, or an entity proves its worth and reliability, it's hardly a gamble. God's sincere faithfulness proven over and over again becomes a given that we count on. We choose to serve a God who's already served us. In seminary, I gave more credit to my younger counterparts for choosing ministry than I gave myself. Young men and women are still in the prime of their life. They have nearly unlimited opportunities and choices. Why choose to serve a God that you barely know and to sacrifice opportunities yet unclaimed? As for me, I was like the Israelites. God had proven steadfast faithfulness, brought me safely through tough times, and accompanied my long path. I encountered obstacles and strangers who made things difficult or impossible. But like the people with Joshua, I knew that I had finally settled and been allowed to do so because of God's sincere faithfulness. In the 34th Psalm, did you notice that line, "Many are the troubles of the righteous"? The righteous are protected, but being spared from trouble doesn't mean you never get in trouble. Many are the troubles of the righteous. Would any of you agree? In our second reading, Paul says the righteous will be disciplined. The righteous will be disciplined, but they won't be punished the same way as those who do evil. Paul goes on to say that evil is not in the flesh, as much as in spirits under control of the devil. And we don't talk much about evil spirits or the devil in the Lutheran Church, but Luther did. See, being raised Catholic probably has something to do with that, because as a child you learn that the devil is real. He's God's enemy and adversary and always at work to undo anything good. Even as a child, I knew whose side I wanted to be on. I probably told you before, but I became born again as a young adult without hesitation when told I had to choose between serving God or the devil. When choosing sides is very important. When there's going to be a match off, you don't wait to be picked or scooped up by the opposing leader. You choose your captain. You decide which side you're going to stand on. Paul uses the word stand 3 times in a row. Withstand. Stand firm. Stand. If you think about wearing armor while you lie down, if you put it on then, what would happen? You'd be stuck horizontal. You wouldn't be able to get up. A person has to choose to stand before putting on the armor. And recognize that each piece of armor was crafted with purpose. And not one piece will do you any good unless you put it on. The belt of truth was designed with a purpose. I'd like to ask you if those belts hanging in your closet right now are doing you any good. They're just things you own. It's something you know you have. Just like the truth that you know. Paul says, use what you own and wear the truth you've been given. As things are constantly changing and we're getting so ridiculously political, I think we need to examine those belts that we claim to own as truth. Perhaps your truth is a little too big for you. Perhaps you need to make another hole in the belt of truth. But you know you're not going to realize what it is unless you put it on. Perhaps your truth no longer serves a divine purpose. It's not just for you alone. You won't know until you wear it. A breastplate of righteousness is made to cover your entire heart and your chest. It's so heavy that every time you breathe, you know you're wearing it. You carry the weight of it directly on your shoulders. Its circumference solidly wraps around your entire upper body. Righteousness is such a hard thing to put on that you don't take it off easily. It's not like a sweater or vest. About those shoes of the gospel of peace. Those are shoes you've got to break in. You've got to experiment without trying to go without. You have to try to go without it like you try to wear shoes without socks and learn that a blister is telling you something. Like shoes we break in, sometimes we overpad our fears by wearing extra layers of protection, when in fact our fears are what are causing us to lose our peace. Paul says, go ahead, pick up your shield of faith. It's pretty heavy, isn't it? You want to know one reason why Roman soldiers were so successful? Because their shields were as tall and as wide as they were. They marched together with their shields touching so no arrows or other weapons could penetrate. I ask if your faith is large enough to cover your whole self. Are you standing near enough to another person of faith so that no arrows of the devil penetrate or other weapons can take your life? If a soldier is on duty or on call, their armor or their uniform is never far at hand. That is, if they're not wearing it. A soldier realizes that each piece is essential. I liken the helmet of salvation to this one hat I have that's non-crushable and has a wide brim. I know I'll never lose it because it has a chin strap. I can always keep it with me because it hangs down my back if I'm not wearing it. So I ask you to consider that you have a non-crushable, wide-brimmed helmet of salvation. You can take it wherever you go. Keep it handy. Maybe your helmet of salvation is a baseball cap. When I did overnight shifts as a chaplain in a large trauma hospital, I would always try to figure out the maximum number of pieces of clothing I could take off during the night. Because during the night, alerts always came over the pager that required a chaplain to immediately show up, be ready for action, fully dressed. My clothes, like armor, were laid close at hand, ready to put on in advance of needing them. Like the armor of God, once you need it, you don't have time to think about getting dressed, because you have to be ready for action and immediately show up. Truth, peace, righteousness, faith, salvation, and God's word are all provisions of God we can wear like armor. They're things made and forged over time with skill and practice. They each need to be sought, used by us with skill, and cared for, knowing their value. Paul finally says, don't forget your sword. It's the only offensive weapon you have. You see, you may survive an attack wearing just armor, but you can't damage evil forces without carrying a weapon. And unlike armor, a weapon doesn't perform by itself, does it, Kyle? You need to wield it. Use of a weapon requires knowledge and skill. Concerning the sword that is the word of God, improper use can hurt you and innocent bystanders. Christians need to practice and learn to use the word of God as intended, so it serves them well. Again, I look at you and I'm grateful that you've come here just to do that. And that you've learned that what Paul suggests is not merely hypothetical or symbolic, but absolutely necessary. In our gospel reading, there's a phrase that I absolutely love. The phrase is, but Jesus. But Jesus always follows people demonstrating their ignorance, making a fuss, or an uproar, as people are prone to do. So I'm waiting for Jesus to say to our society, our story to be told, at this turning point, but Jesus. Because but Jesus is a bugle call to attention for everyone to listen up. He basically says, you have a problem with what I'm saying? What about this? What if, surely, then we know what's coming, we would get quiet and be set, ready to be straightened up. Jesus says, what if you saw, as we're arguing, what if Jesus said, well, what if you were to see me to ascend back to the place where I was? You all are arguing about the flesh, but the Spirit gives life. The flesh is useless. What I'm offering you is both Spirit and life, but some of y'all don't believe it. But that's okay. My Father knows who can come to me. Many turned back and no longer went about with him. I wonder how much armor is sitting unclaimed as inventory on the shelf. Because whenever you start talking about battle against evil that's been waged in this world between God and the devil, some people, some good Lutherans turn away. So I ask you the same question that Jesus asked the 12. Do you wish to go away? Will you commit to wearing a belt of truth and a breastplate of righteousness? Do you know where your helmet of salvation is? Or where your shield of faith stands? In what condition are your shoes of peace? Do they need to be resoled? Are they in the back of your closet or are they nearby ready to slip on? How about polishing up that sword by committing to read the Word of God daily? It's a discipline. Even I struggle to do it. Let us pray. Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we've come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God. Help us at all times to pray in the Spirit, to be kept alert and to persevere. Help us stand boldly in armor, but also to rest deeply in your loving care. Where else and to whom can we go? Only you have everything we need, including eternal life. We do believe and know you're the Holy One of God, who has chosen us to be your soldiers, your disciples, and your children. In your holy name we pray.
Thank you.
make together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of courage, bless all leaders and followers of your church. Ready us to don armor in defense of our faith and to fight against evil. Help us live righteously, proclaim truth, speak the gospel of peace, and keep close at hand our helmet of salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of creation, bless fields and orchards. Protect land from flood, drought, and flame.
Bring life-giving rain for growth. Instruct people in wise treatment of the world. You have provided all for all your creatures. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of community, bless all who seek justice between nations and peoples. Give guidance to bridge builders. Heal divisions and inspire cooperation in times of crisis, disaster, and war. Don't let the voices of media and politics cloud the real issues. Clear confusion surrounding vaccines, rules, and mandates. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of compassion, bless all who are in need, especially those on our prayer list. And please remember Carter Tweed, Peg Kissinger, Kathy Pop, and Kathy Kiefer. Accompany all who are lonely and feel abandoned. Remind them of your abiding presence. Accompany all who are persecuted and exploited. Open our ears to cries most often ignored. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of change, bless our transitions. Guide all who embark on new stages of life, such as a new job, a new school, or a new community, or a new identity. Sustain enduring friendships and kindle new relationships and interests. Don't let the devil succeed at doing evil and are stealing the joy of the Lord, which is our strength. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of comfort, bless all who mourn the absence of neighbors, friends, and loved ones. We give you thanks for the saints who have gone before us. Renew our confidence in your promise of resurrection and life in the world to come. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, we trust that you hear and receive not only these prayers, but those in our hearts and spirits known only to you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Thank you.
that our Savior gave his disciples. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Today I'm going to use another benediction that's found elsewhere in the Bible in 2 Thessalonians, verses 16 through 18. Now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times, in all ways. And also may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ himself, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with each and all of you.
Mm-hmm.